All right. Well, good morning, everyone, and welcome to today's Exploring by the Seat of Your Pants event. My name is Joe Grabowski, and I'll be your host for today. This month is all about space exploration on Exploring by the Seat of Your Pants. We have an amazing series of events with astronauts, with scientists, with engineers from all kinds of organizations like NASA, the Canadian Space Agency, ESA, SpaceX, and more. So it really is an exciting month of events that we do have for classrooms. If you head over to exploringbytheseat.com, you can find all of the events and how you can tune in or snag a camera spot to interact directly with our speakers. So we have a really great event today. It's always great to host Nicole Stott. Nicole has explored the heights of outer space to the depths of our oceans. She's a veteran NASA astronaut. Her experience includes 2 spaceflights and 104 days living and working in space on both the Space Shuttle and the International Space Station. As an artist, she's now retired from NASA. Nicole combines her artwork and spaceflight experience to inspire creative thinking about solutions to our planetary challenges, to raise awareness of the surprising interplay between science and art, and to promote the amazing work being done every day in space to improve life right here on Earth. She is also the founder of the Space for Art Foundation. So I'm gonna bring Nicole in here live with us from Florida. Nicole, so great to have you joining us today.
Yeah, nice to be here with you again, Joe.
All right. Well, it sounds like you're enjoying a little bit of a warmer day than I am here in rainy Canada, but we're excited to get to know you a little bit better and check out some of your experiences.
Okay. Well, I put together some slides that I'll try to speak to really quickly. You know, I'm a rambler, so I'll try to, you know, to control myself and just share a little bit of my experience. I'll try to focus a little bit more on kind of the exploration side of what that was all about, given that we're talking about World Space, you know, week and month. And also this whole, you know, I love your exploring by the seat of our pants thing. And then I have a little video that you'll play for us at the end. And I'm really looking forward to the questions and answers because for me, that's the most fun part of this. Anyway, so I'm gonna try to see if I can work the share your screen magic here. All right, so share and screen. And I'll go here and here. All right, how'd that work?
All right, we got it.
Okay, and are you seeing me too or are you just seeing the slides?
You're just in a tiny box in the corner.
Okay, cool. Just so I know what you know, where if I'm like gesturing all over the place, what it looks like. All right. So, and Joe has seen this picture before, but I wanted to share with everybody, this is really my favorite picture from space when I think about what it was like to be in space. And I love it because it's really, really pretty. I hope you agree. And when you're in space and you're looking back at Earth and you're, you know, looking out to the stars too, it is beautiful. I also like it because, you know, that little image that you see in the middle of the screen, that's a silhouetted view of the Space Shuttle Atlantis. And I like that it just has this still kind of look to it, you know, even though I know that we are traveling around the planet 16 times a day at 17,500 miles an hour, or about 5 miles a second. So it's anything but still in real life there. And I also know that inside of that little spaceship, I'm there with my 5 crewmates. We're on our way home after my first mission, which was about 3 months in space. And the last thing I know is that my crewmate and friend, Jeff Williams, who took this picture, he's still on the space station and has a couple months to go. So it kind of pulls together all of my thoughts of being in space. The way I got there, just really quickly, I'm going to talk through. I think it all starts with inspiration for all of us. I'm really happy that you're all online today and thinking about space in one way or another, just helping it, you know, using it to help you inspire whatever it is you want to do, you know, the path you want to take. Mine started with a family who shared what they loved with me. My dad loved to build and fly small airplanes like this. So even before I could see over the cockpit, like in this picture in the front, I was getting to kind of separate from the planet and really enjoy what it was like to fly, but also get this passion for wanting to know how things fly as well. And that led me to studying aeronautical engineering at school because I discovered if you want to know how things fly, that's one of the things you can study. And while I was there, I really figured out, and I went to school right up the street from the Kennedy Space Center here in Florida. And while I was there, I discovered, man, if you want to know how airplanes fly, why would you not want to know how rocket ships fly? And very fortunate, after I graduated from college, it was right when we were getting back to flying the space shuttles again. And I got a job working there as a NASA engineer on the space shuttle program and later on the space station program. And while I was there, that led me to thinking more about the astronaut job. Because while I was working at the Kennedy Space Center, I was seeing all these astronauts come through that we were getting the space shuttles ready to fly for. And I started thinking, man, you know, most of their job, like 99.9% of an astronaut's job, is actually here on Earth. It's not flying in space. And at least 80% of it, as far as I could tell, was a lot like what I was already doing as a NASA engineer. So I spoke to a couple of people that I considered to be my mentors, and they just really just encouraged me to pick up the pen and fill out the application for the astronaut job. And that was really, really difficult for me to do. It sounds so simple, but it was really, really difficult for me to do because up until that point, I really thought, you know, this astronaut job, it sounds so cool. They do such amazing things to, you know, in space. It's all about improving life on Earth. But why would they pick me? I mean, that's a job other special people get to do. And so it took that encouragement from those people that I trusted to just get me to pick up the pen and do the one thing I had total control of. And then that opened up all these really amazing opportunities. I interviewed the first time and didn't get selected, but they offered me this job. I'm showing this picture of these airplanes because as a person who loved to fly and knowing how things fly, I didn't think it could get any better. I was offered a job flying on the shuttle training aircraft, which is the airplane in the bottom left picture, where we trained the astronauts how to land the space shuttle. And then about 2 years later, I interviewed again for the job and was selected in the class of 2000, probably before a lot of you were born. So it seems like a long time ago to me too. Can't believe it was 20 years. This is the class of people that I was selected with. I love this picture because, first of all, it shows that we were the Bugs. Our class name was the Bugs, and we were having fun here. We'd only known each other for about 2 weeks when this picture was taken. So I see the personality of everyone in this picture now. We all came from different, you know, backgrounds to get us to this same place. And that's one thing I'd just like to share with you is that it's really cool how you can, you know, you think about it, all people in this picture wanted or figured out at some point that they would like to be an astronaut and applied for that. But every single one of the people had a different path there, whether it was school or what they ended up doing for work. So that's something to keep in mind. You really need to pay attention to what you enjoy. And you probably notice I've got a couple folks pointed out in this picture. And that's just to say that this Bug class is pretty special. Bob and Doug are the two guys that just flew that, if you follow along with the space flights, the SpaceX, the first crewed mission on a Dragon, that was Bob and Doug in this picture. And a little interesting tidbit of information is that both of their wives are in this picture too, Karen and Megan. They're in the middle row, blonde hair and then short dark hair. And Megan will actually be flying on one of the upcoming SpaceX Dragon missions early next year. So a lot of experience in this picture. When I was selected, we were flying space shuttles and the Soyuz and the Russian Soyuz. So we go to, it's like we're going back to school, learning all about the systems on the spacecraft and stuff. And I just love this picture because I think it's so beautiful. It's of the final rollout of the Space Shuttle Discovery for launch. And my second mission was flying on the final space or the final flight of the Space Shuttle Discovery. And so I think this is one of the most beautiful pictures. It's kind of this beauty that almost hides all the complexity in this rocket ship that's there. But I think it's a beautiful way to present it. We train to fly in space in all kinds of different simulators. This is one we have at the Johnson Space Center. It's this big dome room with video all around, and you get into the mock-up of the module on the space station, and you get to fly the robotic arm. And it's as close as we can get to what it would be like to, you know, to do this in space. And, you know, because right now, sadly, you can't fly to space to learn to fly in space. So we do all of this stuff down here on Earth. And most of what we're doing is, in one way or another, about how you work together as a team, as a crew. And we do that in a lot of different ways. And that's whether we're studying Russian language in a classroom, whether we're doing that simulator work like you saw in the last picture, or we actually go off and do some really cool expeditionary training out in the wilderness, you know, coldest winter in 100 years in Moscow or the Black Sea or up there in Canada. And Valcartier, we did some cold weather survival too. But the absolute best was going and living underwater for 18 days on this habitat called Aquarius. The best analog to what it's like to fly in space. And then I just throw this picture in here because I think it's important. You know, come back, like that picture that I showed you of my dad and flying in his airplane. It's what I love about experiences like this. This video thing we're doing with, you know, with Joe and exploring by the seat of your pants. It's like, we all need to be sharing the experiences we have to encourage others to find what they're interested in. And so my husband and I have tried really hard to do that with our son, Roman. And this is just an assortment of pictures of him getting to experience some of the same stuff that I was experiencing. One day you finally get to launch. It's a mystery how you get selected to be a crew member on any space flight, but I can tell you it is worth it. I highly recommend it. It's quite the ride, and I hope that I can sit in on some sessions where you guys are sharing your pictures of launching to space someday too. Where I went both times was the International Space Station. And I hope you guys all know about the International Space Station. It is absolutely a masterpiece in space. I mean, I think this, it just looks just like this beautiful, like sculpture almost hanging there and circling the Earth. Best example of living off the grid that you can find, those big solar arrays on either side of the station. We've essentially built this, like this ginormous mechanical system that's like the size of a football field that is mimicking the best we can what Earth does for us naturally as a life support system so we can live and work there. And these are people that I got to live and work there with on my first mission. I show this because I think in all of that that we're doing, you know, learning how to work as a crew, as a team, one of the key things to me is that you want to be able to enjoy yourself in these experiences and the work that you're doing. So you want to know that you're going to enjoy your time with the people that you're with. And then you also want to know that when stuff does go wrong, that you'll have each other's backs, you know, that the professional will come out and you will have each other's back and keep each other safe. And that's how I felt about these people in this picture. Two of them are Canadians, by the way. You've got my dear friend, Bob Thirsk, who's coming in, you know, kind of floating sideways from the right side of the screen. And then the gentleman in the front row, second from left, is Guy Laliberté, was the founder of Cirque du Soleil and considers himself a clown. So he brought up the noses for us and he spent about 10 days with us on the space station. Really wonderful man. And we go to the space station, right? It's like this big laboratory in space. We go there and we do all this science because we can take gravity out of the equation, right? We can look at things we thought we understood in a whole new way and discover new things that help us, sure, explore further off our planet, but also everything about it is bringing back things that can improve life here on Earth. Transition a little bit here now from that to this view out the window. We have a module on the space station now called the cupola, and this is a picture of it. And it's like this big bay window. It's got seven windows, you know, six around the outside and that big circular one in the middle, and it faces straight towards Earth. And I can tell you, if an astronaut has spare time on the space station, this is where you will find them. And our planet is as pretty or prettier than you think it might be from here down on Earth. It is stunning. I remember getting to space and looking out the window and just being like in awe of how crystal clear the colors were, all these colors that you know Earth to be, how they just glowed, and there was this iridescence. And it was against like the blackest black I had ever seen. And this reality of, you know, you can look in this picture and you kind of see that thin blue outline around the planet. And that's our atmosphere. I mean, that's what's kind of like the hull of our spaceship that's surrounding the planet and protecting us all. And I wanted to see Florida from space, which is in this picture, because I considered Florida my home. But it very, very quickly evolved to this planet being my home. And looking out the window and seeing things that were surprising, like my crewmate Al crawling along the bottom of the space station and not falling off and having that seem like it was normal. I don't know, just looking at Earth kind of like art and being surprised, but I would see every time I looked out the window. And this is a picture, big zoom lens on, zoomed way in, of a tiny little chain of islands on the northern coast of Venezuela called Las Rocas. It, for me, is my favorite picture that I took while I was in space. And it has been the inspiration for me since retiring from NASA and moving on to that next mission in life. As Joe mentioned, I'm, you know, doing some artwork now. I actually had the chance to paint with watercolors in space, and I used a picture of that little chain of islands as the inspiration for that painting that I did in space. And it has led me to using art down, you know, back here on Earth to sharing my spaceflight experience, but also getting the chance to work with kids all over the world on these really cool projects where we use the inspiration of spaceflight as kind of, you know, with the healing power of art to bring these kids together. I'm going to show you a little video. I'm going to zoom really quickly through this just to show you an example of one of these projects that we worked on, which is this art spacesuit project where we get kids from all over the world in hospitals and refugee centers to paint for us. And then we take their paintings and our spacesuit company, ILC Dover, who makes our real spacesuits, they take those paintings and they sew them all together into these really colorful spacesuits. And that's Gary there. He, smart guy. He not only sewed these suits together, but he was able to pack the whole thing up into the helmet. It went on a SpaceX Dragon cargo vehicle, flew to the station. One of our astronauts, Jack Fisher, wore the suit and talked to the kids down on the ground and across all the different space station countries where the kids had participated. And they got to see their artwork in space like that. And then we got to watch Unity fly through the space station. It was very cool. And I'm really happy that they got to see their art like that in space. And now, if I can make it do it, there we go. So I'm going to come back. So this whole idea of exploration, right? We go off the Earth. Really, and the words at the end of that video, it's the motto for the International Space Station is off the Earth for the Earth. So no matter how far we are going out into our solar system and then hopefully beyond into the universe, we are learning all kinds of new things about other planets. Like in this picture, this, you know, the Cassini mission to Saturn, you know, we learn all kinds of new stuff about Saturn. And in every one of these missions though, we're always looking for how we can learn more about ourselves. And in this picture, you see a tiny little dot of light down kind of in the bottom right, and that is us. We are always looking for that relationship, that tie back to who and where we are in space as well. And I'll end now. This is my very favorite picture of that kind of relationship, of seeing the reality of who and where we all are together in space on our planet. And, you know, it's a really complex thing to get to space, to live in space, even for a short period of time, to do all that science that's going on up there, and then to come home safely. But in all of it, I learned, I think, three very simple lessons that I'd like all of you to take away with you today. And that's that we live on a planet. We're all Earthlings, and the only border that matters is that thin blue line of atmosphere that blankets and protects us all. And I would ask you to leave here today as crew members of Spaceship Earth. All right, Joe, that's, I think, all the slides. So I'm going to stop sharing. And I'm going to go back here. And then I think we can play, if we play the video, I think it's only like 3 minutes long.
Yeah.
And we can play that. And that gives the, I think, you know, it's so much better than me just rambling on the slides. And it gives just this really nice view of what's going on inside the station and other crew members and that kind of thing too.
All right. So those classrooms who are tuning in via YouTube and Facebook, get your questions ready in the chat sidebar. Those who are live on camera with us will be joining you shortly. But I'm going to play the video and then we will jump into a little Q&A action.
Got a package full of wishes, a time machine, a magic wand, a globe made out of gold. No instructions or commandments, laws of gravity or indecisions to uphold. Printed on the box I see, Acme's built a world to be. Take a chance, grab a piece, help me to believe it. What kind of world do you want? Think anything. Let's start at the start, build a masterpiece. Be careful what you wish for. History starts now.
All right. Well, Nicole, great video. And I think, you know, what you said about leaving the planet and, you know, seeing the United States or Florida as your home. But then once you're up there and you look down, it really changes your perspective. And I think, oh, we'd be in a pretty good spot if everybody could have that experience. And the whole planet is our home, not just that one little part where we are right now.
Yeah, you know, Joe, I think that's, if there's one message that I can share from my space flight, it's that. And it's funny because we learn that, what, in kindergarten, right? We learn we live on a planet. We know we're all on the same place and that we're in space, right? But we just, I don't know, there's this tendency to not like actively think about that, right? And so I'll tell you, I encourage people every day, go outside, stand barefoot with your feet in the grass, you know, look up at the sky and think about how thin, you know, it seems to go on forever, right? Like that blue goes on forever. And yet it's, you know what, like 70 miles? I mean, we can, you know, drive, ride our bikes, you know, that distance and be out of the, I mean, there's so much to that. But I agree with you. If everybody could get that view, it would be fantastic. But honestly, I just look at my backyard now. You were camping, right? You said you were camping out in the frozen tundra out there. And I mean, when you look around yourself, I think you can find that same awe and wonder that can get that in you as well. So I hope everybody tries to do that. It's a very positive thing to have happen to you.
Absolutely. Okay. Well, let's start meeting some of our classrooms. Yes. I want to give a shout out to two of the classrooms on camera right now. We've got Mrs. Burns' group joining us in Stirling, Ontario, a grade 6 class. And we've also got, Mrs. Zaremba's class joining us in Beaumont, Alberta. So their devices aren't hooked up, but if you use the chat bar, you can send us in your questions there and I'll make sure that we work them in. But for now, let's head to North Bay. Let's go to Ms. Saunders' grade 6 class.
Hi, my name is Sheena. I'm from North Bay. When's living on space station, what was the hardest thing?
Okay, so I think I understood. What was the hardest thing about living on the space station? Is that true? Is that it? Okay, yeah. You know, I think the most difficult thing about living on the space station was that my family didn't get to be there with me. Because even the things that we thought would be, or that I went into, like the idea of flying in space with thinking that they would be difficult, were really just different. They were, I don't know, like part of the adventure, right? Everything from how you go to the bathroom to how you got to keep track of your stuff because it all floats around. You got to really, really be organized. To just what it's like to move, you know, to fly and move in three dimensions. It was all just different. So when I think about what was difficult, it really, for me, comes down to not having my family there with me, getting to enjoy it as well, if that makes sense.
Yeah, absolutely. Our grade 9s joining us in Alberta sent us in a question. So Ethan and Santini would like to know, kind of sticking with the feelings, how did you feel physically and emotionally during the takeoff? Can you remember anything that went through your mind?
Yeah. Let me just tell you, awesome ride. And on the space shuttle, it was a very dynamic ride because we had those big solid rocket boosters that were really what lifted us off the planet and into space. You know, you're shaken, you know, almost like you can't believe your body would shake like that inside. And you get this, I remember when we launched, like it went from being like, oh my gosh, was I ever on a launch pad kind of feeling, like getting kicked from behind and feeling like three of me was sitting on top of me as we accelerated, and the shaking and your body responds to it, right? So this big smile comes across your face. You're like high-fiving your crewmate next to you and the little like woohoo, you know, coming out. You just almost can't control it. It's like as humans, we have to kind of respond to it. So just a wonderful, like exciting ride. So physically that's what it was like. And you went from that to 8.5 minutes later, circling the planet and floating, you know, from this like intense dynamic ride to just this peaceful, graceful, you know, if you let your arms relax, they floated up, just really kind of surreal feeling between those two extremes. Emotionally, I think it was interesting because the way I get like the emotional question most of the time is like, was I afraid? Was I frightened by what was I thought was going to go on and what was going on? And I think the answer to that is no, but I was respectful of where I was and, you know, how much exploding rocket fuel was happening underneath me and what it took to get to space on a spaceship. But I don't think I was afraid of that because we train so much for what we can do as humans to respond to situations in the spaceship. What I think concerned me, though, was thinking about, again, it goes back to my family, you know, thinking about my husband and my son, who was 7 years old when I flew the first time, and my mom and sisters and friends watching me do this. Because it is a lot more difficult to watch somebody, you know, that you love strap into a rocket and fly to space than it is to be the person who is trained, you know, to do it. Yeah. Yeah.
Right. Yeah. Very cool. Yeah. I can only imagine the wild ride.
Yeah.
I'm going to bring in the Adams family.
The Adams family. Awesome.
In Alberta. There they are. You want to go ahead and unmute for me?
Hi,
there they are.
Honey.
Hey, Adams family.
Hi.
We have a question for you.
Okay.
You said that off the earth, for the earth was a motto. What is your personal motto just to get you through? Or if you have any words of encouragement for future scientists?
Wow. I would say now, kind of in hindsight that I, you know, have experienced things, you know, going through, is one thing is you have to, you know, I told you the story about it taking somebody to encourage me to pick up the pen and fill out the application, right? The one thing in that whole process that I had control of. And I think we have to find the way to really lift ourselves up, you know, to find those mentors, your parents who, you know, really believe in you, see something maybe in you that you might not, and help you gain that confidence to do those kinds of things, like picking up the pen and filling out the application. Because that was difficult for me. The other thing is I think there's something to this. I've heard this phrase before, see it, be it, right? You know, to imagine, to dream about something that you really, really are interested in or would like to do or experience it, and then see yourself in that place. And it's amazing how like the things you'll become interested in at school will change because they can help you get there. The people that you'll meet who can share their experiences with you. Like, I think you guys coming on to this session today, there was something that interested you about it and something that maybe you thought would help you achieve what you want to in the future. And then I would say my number one motto, I don't know where my little card went. I have from one of those mentors that encouraged me to pick up the pen is here's how you can, not why we can't. And to always go into everything that you're doing, even if it's really, really challenging, with the idea that you will find the solution. And that just puts you in a much better place to actually have that happen than trying to figure out all the reasons why you can't do something. All right, I rambled. I hope that was helpful.
No, I think that was great. Great answer. We're now heading to Hamilton. We've got Miss Fisher's grade sixes. Hey, grade sixes.
Hi.
Hi, Hamilton.
Hi. Hi. My name is. Hi, my name is Anas, and I have a question for you.
Hi, Ernest.
Anas.
Anas, I'm sorry. It's the masks, you know.
What was your experience going into space worth the risk?
Ah, that, you know, that's a really good question. Yes, I think it was, and would be again if I got the chance to do it. I would not have done it if I didn't think it was worth the risk. I think there's more to it than just the adventure right, of flying in space, just experiencing that ride to and from space, just the time there. And it's because everything we're doing there is about figuring out ways to improve life on Earth. I mean, I honestly believe that. And helping us figure out how to explore farther off our planet, right? Which, again, I believe is ultimately about improving life here on Earth. So, yes. And the other side of the answer to that question is that I had worked for years with the people that were building these spaceships, right? I showed you that picture standing, this whole group of people in front of the Space Shuttle Endeavour, I think, on the runway. And I got to know that just the way these people worked together, their belief in what they were doing, that they were responsible and as much as you could be for making these spaceships safe for us to fly, that's what gave me the confidence too in being able to do it. But absolutely believe that it's worth the risk.
All right. Great question. So we've got our grade sixes here joining us. They sent us in two questions here. One's from Luke. And Luke wants to know about, I think you mentioned it took 8 minutes from launch to get to space, but how much longer to dock with the space station? And then Marley wants to know, zero gravity, how did your body cope? Did you feel sick initially?
Yeah. Okay. So so from launch to the time we were orbiting the planet was 8.5 minutes. So, I mean, to think about that, it's really cool. You know, you go from zero to 17,500 miles an hour and falling around the planet in 8.5 minutes. On the space shuttle, it took us about a day and a half to kind of chase down the space station. And we could have gotten there quicker, but we would do that so that we could get in orbit with the space station or the space shuttle, and we could check out all of the systems on the space shuttle. You know, we could make sure that our radios were working, that our air conditioning system was working, that all of the stuff that we needed to just be safe and in space on the space shuttle were working before we would dock with the space station. And yeah, it was about a day and a half. And that was a really interesting ride, because you get to space and then all of a sudden it seems like as you're chasing the station down, as you're going around the planet together, all of a sudden it's like out of nowhere, you see this tiny, tiny little dot of light that your computers are telling you is the space station. And then as you get closer and closer, it's like that little dot of light turns into this little miniature space station that's about, you look at it, it looks like it's about the size of your fingernail. And then almost out of nowhere, it's like the thing is ginormous. You can't see from one end to it to the other, and you're about to hook up with it. It's incredible how we can do that kind of thing. And then the zero gravity question is really good too, because that's, you know, now you've been floating around inside of the space shuttle and now you dock with this station and the hatch opens up and now you're inside this really, really big volume of space station. I mean, it's quite large inside the space station. But I was really lucky. I felt very good getting to space. I didn't have any kind of motion sickness feeling at all. And what's interesting about that is there's nothing about the way your body responds to, you know, being on a boat or a ship or in an airplane doing or on a roller coaster here on Earth that's going to tell you really how you're going to respond to getting to space or to coming back to gravity, coming home. And I just got lucky on the way to space, got lucky. I watched some of my crewmates who were not so lucky, but the cool thing is that every single one of them very quickly, like within a day, was over that. And when they flew again, they never felt that feeling again. It's like your brain and your body figures it out.
All right. Very cool. I'm going to bring in Thomas. He's joining us in Saskatchewan. Thomas, go ahead and unmute for me.
Hi.
I have a question. Hey. What was your favorite part in astronaut training?
Oh, wow. My favorite part in astronaut training. You know, that's a really difficult question because there's so many things about it that are just really interesting and different kinds of things that you get to do that, you know, that I wouldn't have been able to do otherwise. I think the things where I was working with my crew, where it wasn't just me doing something, it wasn't just me studying, you know, the systems or me studying how to speak Russian, which by the way, was the most difficult thing I had to do as part of astronaut training. But the experience is where we were really, where we were working as a crew, and we were working on the things that we knew we were going to do in space, right? So whether that was the science experiments or like I showed you the underwater mission, you know, going and living underwater together for almost 3 weeks and just experiencing that in a way that was preparing us to live and work in space. Because I think like most things in life, everything you do, really the best of it, you know, is about the way you share that with, you know, with other people. So that would probably be it. You know, we do really cool stuff though, you know, spacewalk training in that big pool and the big suit, getting to fly in the T-38 jets. That's all really, really fun stuff and interesting, but sharing it with the other people was probably the best.
All right. I want to grab in a couple of quick questions from our YouTube crew. Will would like to know how you sleep in space. And then Ms. Cocker would like to know what the temperature would have been like outside of the space station. What's it like in space?
Okay. So sleep in space, absolute best sleep I've ever had in my entire life. We sleep on the space shuttle, you know, kind of in a smaller area. We always sleep in sleeping bags and, you know, you can stick your sleeping bag anywhere you want. I would always stick mine on what you would think of as the ceiling of the space shuttle, because where else can you sleep on your ceiling than in space? Because there is no, I mean, you really have no sense of up or down. On the space station, each of us had a private crew compartment, like sleep station, and that was very dark and quiet, and the temperature was good, and you'd stick your sleeping bag up on the wall, and man, within 5 minutes, once I had the lights out, I was asleep, and I did not wake up until the alarm went off, whether that was my alarm I'd set on my watch or the alarm, you know, the emergency alarm going off in the middle of the night. The best sleep. The question about the temperature outside. Yeah, I had a chance to do a spacewalk, and it's incredible to me how we can build these little miniature, you know, like miniature spaceships, really, our spacesuits that allow us to go out into the vacuum of space and survive and do our work. And knowing that when we were in, like when the sun was out for us, it was probably up to, you know, plus 250 degrees Fahrenheit, to when we were in the shaded side, you know, down to like minus 250 degrees Fahrenheit. So not temperatures that you could survive in, you know, without protection, and how those suits just beautifully, you know, the suits that ILC Dover builds for us, just beautifully protect us that way and allow us to work out there like that. Yeah.
Okay. So I want to see if we can squeeze one more question in here. Go ahead.
My name is Winston, and I was wondering, were there any effects on your body when you came back to Earth?
Great question. We have actually, it's interesting because there are scientists and doctors that all of their studies are based on what happened to Nicole and the other astronauts when they get back from space, right? This, you know, this influence of having been in that microgravity environment. From a physical, just feeling standpoint, I can tell you every astronaut, when they get back, feels really, really heavy. I mean, almost to the point of where the bottom half of your leg feels like it weighs 100 pounds, and you're like, how, you know, you have to think about holding your head up and standing up straight. And, you know, I try to share that in a way that says, you know, there really is truth in how much value just getting out of our chairs and off the couch and moving around and being active, you know, is to our health. You know, that gravity is a really heavy force on us. But our bodies change from being in space. You know, the fluids all shift in our bodies when we're in space. They all kind of move up towards your head. So you get kind of a congested feeling. They're starting to study how that's affecting kind of pressure on the back of our eyes and, you know, long-term vision changes. Your bones, you know, when you get to space and you're floating, you know, your body and your brain figure out really quickly, hey, I don't need bones or muscles to, you know, move around and float like this. So I'm not going to waste any energy maintaining them. So we have to like exercise 2 hours a day and really kind of fight that bone loss, so that when we get back to Earth, our bones are healthy and, you know, we can move around in gravity again. And so there's a lot of studies into the way our bodies change that way too. But pretty much everything about your, just your body as a system, you know, if you think about it as your, you know, as your spaceship, it's like it's being affected in some way by both going to space and then coming back. Yeah.
I'm going to come back in here one more time. I want to start off by doing a huge shout out to all of our YouTube classrooms. Thank you so much for tuning in and sending some great questions. Thank you to our classrooms and homeschools that joined us live on camera today. Great to see you and great to take your questions. And then of course, Nicole, thank you for joining us World Space Week. Thanks for sharing your story, your insights. I don't think it's rambling if it's all good stuff. It's like, oh, and I forgot, I always like to add this in the intro, but I forgot this time. Nicole starred in a Super Bowl commercial last year. I always like to work that in, and I forgot this time. I'm glad I got it in. Nicole, thank you so much. Such a pleasure.
Thanks. Always great to see you, Joe.
All right. Well, thanks so much, everyone. Stick around if you want. In about 10 minutes, we're going live with Julie. Julie is an electronics engineer with NASA's Jet Propulsion Laboratory, and she's going to talk about the work she did for the, or she's doing for the Europa Clipper mission. So if you can tune in, stay on a little longer. It should be a good one. But thanks so much, everyone. Signing off for now.